Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Built for the Pursuit podcast. My name is Carlos, and I've got Bob here. And we also have our wonderful guest for this episode, Kate Lamaze, who is an ambassador for us for how long have we been working? I don't know. 2 years?
Two, 3 years? Two, going on three, I think. Yeah.
Always been a big fan of your YouTube channel and kind of the story you're telling from that perspective of that, you know, what it's like to hunt, that kind of public story, doing it yourself. And it's always been cool to see what you've been up to. So how have you been?
Thanks. I've been really good. Just, you know, it's deer season now, so we're getting after it. And I shot one deer already this year, so that's pretty exciting.
I think we saw that was at Kentucky.
Yeah.
Yep.
Early season.
That one was really fun. It was actually a giveaway hunt that I was doing. So I had a girl who won from Texas, and she had some close calls, but wasn't able to shoot anything. But I shot a really nice deer. He ended up going 160 3/8. So
okay,
pretty awesome. Pretty cool way to start the season.
Yeah,
it's a great start. Yeah.
That's what Bob and I are hoping for, to aspire to someday.
Yeah.
So that was a giveaway hunt. Like, what was it like hunting with that kind of winner? What's that experience like? Getting someone who just, like, you're meeting someone and then doing that.
Yeah, was it someone you didn't know, obviously?
Yeah, it was totally random. I think there was like 4,000 entrants. It was, you know, just, you never know who you're going to get. But it was really cool. She's about my age, and first of all, it was cool that a girl won it. You know, that's just, obviously, I think that would be fun to hunt with a girl. So, her, and she ended up, bringing her boyfriend along. So it was them. And they were both really awesome. They're from Texas and, you know, just sweet little Southern girl. So I guess they hunt down in Texas a little bit, but not like, she's pretty inexperienced. So that was like cool. Just kind of like helping her. You know, we were shooting a little bit at camp, and I was helping her like through her shot process and kind of getting through her nerves and all that. So she was like really excited. And I think she just had a good time regardless. Like, you know, she had some really close opportunities at bucks. So I think she was just excited about the whole thing, just winning and, you know, having opportunities. So
that's cool.
It was a lot of fun.
How many days were you guys there?
It was five.
Okay.
Five full days of hunting.
It's nice. Awesome.
So yeah, it was a good time.
And that was a few weeks ago or a week? When was that?
That was the second week of September.
Second week of September. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you've also been kind of working on some other projects, kind of working on some property, right?
So Iowa, I have a lease, and I've been doing some projects with Onyx and just a whole lease series and hunting here. So, that's been going really good. I don't have as many bucks as I thought I was going to this year. For whatever reason, a few of them didn't show back up, but we have two really good ones. So I'm pretty excited about it.
Yeah. How much time have you been able to spend kind of getting ready for that and kind of learning that property? And
so this is the third year that we've had this place.
Okay.
So I'm kind of at the point where I know it pretty well now.
Yeah.
And as far as like these particular deer that we have history with both of them. So it's been fun like watching them. They're both five this year. So we've had them since year one, and, you know, just watching them grow and stuff is really cool. And now they're of course old and smart, so they're a little difficult to hunt, but it's been fun just kind of managing the property, because I do tend to hunt a lot of public land, so the lease just in general is like new to me. Like, just having a lease to do stuff with is just a new concept, so that is cool too, like food plots and actually being able to put stands in trees and like leaving them there.
Yeah,
so it's been really fun.
Have you moved your cameras around much since, so like here in Kansas, right? Like about this time of year, crops are coming in and stuff. And so every once in a while, like early in the summer, you know, I've got them over food or, you know, on an edge where there might be an ag field or something. But do you move them around at all, or do you kind of keep them set?
Yeah, so I actually just moved some this morning. So now that we've had the lease for like 3 years, there's definitely spots that we just leave cameras because we know that like at some point there's going to be a buck there.
Sure.
And honestly, a lot of them are on scrapes. So you don't really have to move those too much, but there's a few. So like the biggest deer that we have right now that I'm hunting, he's showing up like on the north end of this one food plot and the south end of the food plot. Like, I don't know, the span is probably like 700 yards, but he's not like in the food plot ever, like on camera. So I'm like, okay, how are you getting from A to B? Like, I know you're walking there. So right now I'm moving some cameras just to try to figure out exactly where he's walking and like traveling, because where I thought he was going to be is just, he's just not there. So that's kind of what I'm working on right now. But
that's awesome.
I think scrapes are just like really hot right now.
Yep. I'm seeing some opening up a little bit too. Yeah. Where we've got the same, we've got a couple small properties, but I do the same thing. I'm like, okay, it's like an 80 acre property or something. Right. And I see them up on the north and it's like, okay, 9 minutes later, they're there. And like, I'm trying to put together the pieces to figure out where do I need to be in the middle. But the bigger ones are evasive for sure.
They know what they're doing.
Yeah.
They're portaling.
Right. Yeah. He's probably teleporting.
Yeah.
Feels that way.
Yeah.
I'm like, seriously, you're on that camera and then, you know, 30 minutes later, you're way down here, but like you didn't hit any of the ones in the middle. How does that happen?
Magic.
Yeah.
But the, you kind of had a buck you've been going after for a while and that whole saga in last year, right? So that,
that was a good one.
I don't know if saga is the right word. I think it felt like that, watching it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But, you know, is that, I mean, do you want to give a little bit of background on that one? I know some people probably know about it, but it'd be good to hear about that again. And then is that, do you have other ones that you're kind of, or have been on the list already, or is there, you're trying to rebuild that list?
Yeah. So that one, that was Swoops. We had him both years. So I had 2 years of history with him, I guess.
Yeah.
And the first year, there were four of us that were hunting the lease, and we all kind of had our own cameras out and just were like sharing pictures here and there. And like, we all were just trying to be like conservative and not step on each other's toes, and also not like go bombing in the big chunk of woods to like, you know, ruin each other's hunts. Basically, we were trying to be careful. So anyway, we knew of Swoops, but he wasn't necessarily a target. He was three. Really nice three-year-old, but, you know, just not one that I was really focusing on, and I never saw him in person, so I just knew him through cameras, and where I thought he was showing up, he wasn't. It was a totally different camera, and that was just the mix-up of everybody sharing pictures. So then last year, or no, excuse me, he was four. So then last year he was five, and I was like, okay, he's big this year, like, I need to focus on him. Like, if there's a deer to shoot, it's him. So I hung cameras and you know, kind of just stayed out and did some scouting through that. I did some observation sits, and luckily I only ended up sitting three times for him before I was able to shoot him. But it was kind of one of those same deals where it's like, okay, he's at point A and he's at point B, but like, how is he getting there? So I had to do some sits and basically sit back and watch, and I had an idea of what he was doing, but it was a matter of just like, okay, I need to see it happen. So I sat and he did exactly what I thought he was gonna do, pretty much just walk the edge of this one finger, and then he would cut down in, and then that's where he would show up on camera. So luckily I had a stand right in that corner, and it just worked out, and it was really awesome because, you know, having history like that is really, really cool, and it's exciting when it all comes together. I don't get that very often on public. So that's another thing with the lease, where it's like having previous knowledge and previous history is helpful, but it's also really cool.
Yeah.
It makes a cool story. That was about this time last year, wasn't it? Or
yeah, actually, the 13th, October 13th.
Gotcha.
So he was in pretty much checking scrapes, and I kind of was just trying to be patient with him and not be too pushy. And I waited basically until he was like almost every single day daylight for like 3 days in a row. And then I was like, okay, there's a chance he's going to do that again. So that's my time to go in there. And it worked out.
Nice. Yeah. October can be tough. So it's impressive.
Yeah. Yeah. And then, yep. Is there, are you, I know you said you have the target buck or the one you're kind of looking at right now. Are you immediately naming them or when is that process? And then, you know, do you have, another one or anything else you're looking at right now?
So, I mean, as far as like naming them, like when they're two, unless they have like some crazy characteristic, I don't usually name them. When they're three, then that's when I start being like, okay, they're probably hanging around here, you know, gonna stay in the general area. So they're worth naming. And Swoops I named because his main beams literally like went like this and swooped up and they were like level with the tops of his tines. The first year that we had pictures of him. So that's how he got his name. But yeah, it kind of just depends. Usually if they have some like quirky characteristic, they'll get a name.
So if you've got other people on the
especially,
lease,
what's that?
If you've got other people on the lease, do they go with your naming or is this does everybody have a different name for him?
No, we share names. Okay. So it was four of us the first year and now it's just me and one other, well, my boyfriend, yeah. Him and I are on it together. So cool. It's kind of nice. There's just two of us now, but yeah, we pick names and he's more basic. Like he'll name it like the wide eight. Or something and I'm over here like Swoops or like yeah. You know something more creative
had some but, flair
so and yeah usually if we're hunting them they'll get a name too like so that way we can just at least talk about them like hey did you see that you know the I don't know Short Twos which is the other deer that I'm hunting did you see Short Twos was on this camera or whatever so Just makes it easier to talk about them
gives it a bit more it's easy to follow.
So
you did that, Kentucky hunt and you know, what's next? What's the rest of the season look like?
So right now I'll pretty much be in Iowa for the rest of October. In a perfect world, I will shoot one in October and then I can just focus on other places the rest of the season. Then I drew Kansas, so I will be in Kansas this year, nice. Which is really awesome. And so that will probably be like mid-November, you know, rut time. And then Missouri, I still have a tag. So I will probably go back. Well, let me backtrack. I'll probably hit Missouri like early November before gun season. And then I'll jump over to Kansas, you know, like mid-November time. And then after that, it's kind of like up in the air as to like what tags got filled. I tried to be a little like more laid back with my tags this year because I feel like in the past I am like so gung-ho to go hunt all these other places and then like I feel rushed and it's like oh I gotta be in this state oh the deer are moving over in this state like I you know so I want to fill tags versus just like having a bunch of tags so I really only have like three major tags this year and then you know if it works out that I fill them all then I'll you know bounce around somewhere else but yeah, pretty much just Iowa, Missouri, Kansas this year.
Okay, nice. Yeah, I geek out on the whitetail. Do you have anything else? Or, I mean, did I see you were getting into waterfowl, or do you do anything outside of the whitetail space then, too?
Yeah, so typically I do antelope hunting. I didn't do it this year because the friends that we go with, they were actually in Africa, so it just didn't work out. But I antelope hunt every year. I've done a mule deer hunt one time and I would like to elk hunt, but I haven't done it. As far as like me having a tag, I have like filmed a few elk hunts. But yeah, I'm recently into waterfowl, but obviously deer are my priority. So that's like kind of on the back burner, but I did shoot two geese, on opening day, which was pretty exciting. Cause I have no clue what I'm doing. So to shoot two is awesome.
Yeah, I think whenever I was reading it, it's like, I luckily shot.
I got lucky.
Yeah. Hey, it's all the same.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think where to take that one. Like it's interesting with the question of like whitetail. So I'll back up a little bit. So with whitetail, you know, that's kind of where a lot of people start. What's like your recommended steps into getting into that? Like what would you recommend? I guess for women getting into hunting, we can focus on that just because I think that's
share like how you got started. Yeah. I don't know if I know that story. So you can.
Sure. Yeah.
So I got started. My dad is a huge whitetail hunter. I'm from Pennsylvania originally. So I grew up just mostly rifle hunting. That's just what he grew up doing. And, you know, it's just PA is like the number one hunting state, basically. Yeah. So everybody hunts. But when I grew up, nobody really archery hunted. And so like my dad, I think when I was 14, crossbows became legal. And so he got me a crossbow so I could like start archery hunting because then I could hunt the whole season versus just like 2 weeks of gun. So him and I kind of learned how to archery hunt together. And so once I got older, obviously I wanted a compound bow. And then that's just kind of how I fell into it. I just really love to do it. My dad was like my biggest influence for sure. And, you know, I still go back and hunt with him in the late season as much as I can. But as far as like getting somebody into it, I feel like I get that question a lot and it's really hard for me to answer because I don't really know if there is like one right way. If I were to like give any advice, I would just say like take somebody out and try to make it as like positive of an experience as you can. Like even if you don't shoot something, maybe try to sit somewhere where you're at least going to see something, or don't take somebody out when it's like the coldest day of the year. You know, just like baby steps into it, and then, you know, obviously they can learn as they, you know, maybe have an interest.
And I know we've gone to a few of the Total Archery Challenges together and ran into each other there, that sort of thing, but do you see that as a good on-ramp for someone just to kind of understand what that actually looks like?
Yeah, I love the Total Archer Challenges. I think I love them the most because it's about as realistic as you can get with like shots, like different types of shots, mm-hmm. versus, you know, somebody just practicing in their backyard shooting at a square block. It is a total archery challenge. Like it's technical. You're shooting through tree limbs or, you know, shooting over a log or, you know, whatever, shooting super steep angles. And I love that about it because it really gives you the like perspective about like, okay, this is like what I may possibly encounter while hunting. Mm-hmm. So I for sure would say it's a good time. And I love that it's not like an actual like competition. So there's no pressure as far as like, you don't have to do well, like, you know, you're just going out and you're having fun with it. So I think that's for sure a great way to get started, you know, at least with archery.
Yeah, it seemed to be a lot of people that I was meeting there were there to just kind of getting into it. And, you know, just that's the step they're taking before actually going to try to go on a hunt. And it was cool to see that.
Yeah.
No scorekeeping, but it's expensive if you lose a dozen arrows, right?
Yeah, that's the incentive to shoot well, right? But yeah, even then, I think people were still having a good time with it just because they're never going to get, like the shot they usually lost the arrow on is something they didn't, it was fun. Like it was crazy or whatever it might be, right? But no, that one's one I think, curious to see what you think of that just as a way from an archery perspective to get up and running. And then from a gear perspective, do you consider yourself like a gear nerd? Or like, are you always trying to figure out all this, like try stuff out, or how do you approach that?
I would say I'm like a test. I'm a field tester. I'm always trying like different things. And the majority of the reason for that is because I am hunting alone a lot. So I'm always looking to like improve my just setup and be as efficient as I can with things. You know, with self-filming, it's like, there's just a lot of complexity to it. So if I can, you know, lighten my pack, or, you know, the less I have to carry, or, you know, use something that's that's really going to help me. I'm always looking for that next thing. So I really like to test things out. And to be honest, with having like a following, I always get questions about different gear and like what I would recommend and stuff. So I think I owe it to people to like try things out because they might not be able to.
Yeah.
And so I can give an honest review on stuff like, yeah, you should get this because blah, 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 you know, or, you know, whatever, or you shouldn't get this because, you know, X, Y, Z. So I really like testing things out. And I'm always open to trying new stuff. So
I know you're doing, you said with the lease, you're doing more kind of fixed stands and stuff like that. I think I've seen you. What's your take on, so when you're in public or kind of just doing a hanging hunt, are you mostly saddle hunting or is that, are you?
Yeah. So, honestly, like this, it kind of works out. So the lease is where I usually just use tree stands and stationary stuff. Where if I am on public, I prefer the saddle. It's just, it's so much easier. It's a lot lighter. And even the sticks, like I work with Tethered. So like they have like the lightest sticks.
Oh yeah.
And it's really awesome just for all the mobile stuff, you know, because when you're on public, you're not necessarily sticking to the same tree. Like I bounce around all the time. So
right.
I really love the saddle, but it is nice having stands on the lease that I can just go crawl up into and not have to worry about sweating or, you know, making too much noise or anything like that. So
that's what ours are.
It's, you know, pros and cons.
I do mostly, yeah, fixed stand stuff. But yeah, at least once, I think I was telling one of the guys here, Josh or somebody, that at least once a year, I try to get in the saddle and try to make sure I can still like physically climb the tree just to like say that I did it. Just that, like first saddle hound of the year is my one and only. And yeah.
First and only.
There's definitely a little knack to it. But yeah, it is pretty cool. So.
And it's crazy seeing that there's so much diversity in like approaching that now. I mean, have you had, is that like, do you get a lot of questions on saddle hunting or is that more like, it seems to be still growing like crazy.
Oh yeah. I mean, I would say most people know what it is, or at least they have heard of it by now. Mm-hmm. But like 2 years ago, it was actually kind of crazy. Like, the amount of questions I would get. And I try to put out videos where I'm like showing you how to hang a saddle or, you know, how I set up my camera gear and bow and situate everything, you know, while I'm in a saddle and stuff like that. And I think that really helps, you know, people, like they can visualize it because it's hard, you know, when you don't know what something is, it's like, okay, cool. It sounds cool, but like, you know, is it practical or, you know, is it worth it? You know, that kind of stuff. So I try to put out content that can like really show people, and then they can decide, you know, for themselves.
Yeah, sure. There's a lot of pieces and can be intimidating even with like your, you know, your ascender and like if you've got a rope man or all these different like tools and stuff where you're like, oh, what is this? Like, I'll just go back to my ground blind.
Right. Yeah. And I think a lot of people are just like intimidated by it because it is weird and it just looks like there's a lot going on. And I even get people, I'll take pictures like, you know, of my setup or whatever. And they're like, you carry way too much. And I'm like, I know it looks like a lot, but it really isn't. Like, it's not that bad. So, you know, I try to show that like, okay, this stuff looks like it's in the way, but it really isn't. You know, I can draw my bow. It's not, you know, it's not hitting my string or something like that. So it's a learning curve.
Yeah. We'll get that question a lot actually on the kind of the bino harness, since it's still kind of something that's new to a lot of people and they think it's going to get in the way of the draw or something like that. It's like, you just have to try it.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's where it's like, that was the other thing I was interesting about. I think TAC's a good event to go try things because there's a lot of people kind of demoing things out. It's cool seeing all the people try that saddle for the first time. It's definitely a good event to go to, but the, I'm trying to think with the public stuff and then I think you made a post recently about changing up your gear or what you're carrying. What do you think that averages in weight? I know people are talking about, I know that it, what is the addition of the camera gear?
You know, I really should just get a scale and weigh it because I don't actually know.
Yeah.
The thing is, I feel like I'm always like tinkering, but I feel like I've narrowed it down about as much as I can. Like I everything I take, I use. I can't really cut too much more out. I really don't even know what it would weigh. But I will say the camera gear is definitely like the majority of my weight.
Yeah.
So like if I were not filming, I would probably not even take a backpack. I would maybe just have like a little fanny pack, saddle, mobile sticks, and then that would be it. So yeah, I don't actually know weight wise, but maybe I should weigh it so people can know.
Yeah. I figured that'd be the number one question, but like, you know, you're talking about all the gear and the weight, but
I know, I'm sorry. I don't know.
No, that's fine.
Heavy, like, I don't know, maybe like 20 pounds, 30 pounds. I don't actually know.
Yeah.
And that's like with my bow and stuff too. So who knows?
Yeah. Well, I'll look forward to that post.
I'll look into that. Get back with you. Yeah.
What bow are you shooting, Caitlin?
I've got the Matthews Prima.
Like it?
I do. Yeah, it's actually my second one. I do a bow giveaway every year, so just kind of a way to give back to people. I'm just do a giveaway, and then I work really closely with a bow shop down in Texas, Corbin's Archery. So he's pretty nice about getting me set up every year, and I couldn't upgrade to like the new Matthews because the draw length was not short enough for me. So I just got another Prima. Gotcha. So it does the job. I like it.
Yeah, I get it. I'm short draw length for the most part here too. The T-Rex arms for me that, what about broadheads? What are you shooting, fixed or mechanical? I think I saw, or is it REK, or what broadhead are you shooting?
Yeah, REK.
Is it REK? Is that, yeah, I've seen it. I never tried them.
Yep. So the only reason I started shooting them is because I'm friends with the guy who founded them.
Oh, cool.
And I'm kind of just trying to help him out. And honestly, that's like my little field testing that I like to do. I was like, I'll shoot them and just let you know. So I shoot his four blade, and this is the second year that I've been using them. And honestly, I really love them. Every animal that I've shot, you know, it makes a hole. Like,
yeah.
Four blades are awesome. I personally prefer those just because they make a hole.
Yeah.
So they fly. Like, I think every fixed head company says like, oh, they fly like a field tip, but like these ones actually do. Like, yeah. As long as your bow's tuned, they are going to fly perfect. So that's probably the best part.
Kentucky, is that what you took down there?
Yeah. Nice. Yep.
Good blood trail. How far did it go?
Not far, maybe 70.
Okay.
Yep. 60, 70, something like that. But yeah, they've been great.
How about arrows? I mean, we're getting into gear. We don't have to go clear down into the like, I'm down just tell asking you questions. Yeah.
Tell us everything.
Are you one of the, you know, we won't get into the hotly debated FOC topic or whatever, but like, tell us about your arrow setup real quick. We don't have to spend a ton of time, but
he's just geeking out right now.
Yeah.
He's just comparing notes with everybody.
Right.
And then he goes, and then after this, he goes,
do a little research.
Like, I'm doing it all wrong.
I like to tinker too.
Yeah. Well, I might throw you for a loop then. So, I don't believe in a very super heavy arrow. I'm not going to get too crazy with all of this because I don't personally know like the math behind everything. I think my FOC is like right around 10% right now. I'm shooting 500 spine. I think my arrow weight's like, let me think, 385.
And what are you pulling weight wise on the Prima?
Total. So I pull 48 pounds with a 25 inch draw.
Okay. Seems like a solid setup.
And I mean, every deer that I've shot, and I pretty much have had the same setup for the last 2 years, even with the new bow. Every deer other than swoops, every deer I've shot, I've had a full pass through, and I have had multiple types of shots. So,
it
works pretty. So
that was a tank of a deer that didn't count on him. He was what, like 250 or 300 pounds or something, right? It was a giant that doesn't count. Yeah.
Yeah. This is going back to me not weighing things. I guess I don't have a scale, but I never got to weigh him, but he was every bit of 250, if not 300 pounds live weight, like biggest bodied deer I've ever seen, like for sure.
Yeah, look giant.
Yeah.
Yeah, big deer.
Now I know what to get you for Christmas. Scale.
Seriously.
So you mentioned rifle hunting with your dad. Is that you said you still try to go do that every year?
So I don't really make it back for rifle season because typically I'm like hunting out here still. But every year I try to go back in the late season. So every year it opens the day after Christmas. It's late archery and muzzleloader. So I try to go back and hunt with him for at least a couple of days.
Okay.
You know, I go visit for the holidays and then we hunt. So
that's cool.
Yeah.
Just to spend time.
Won't lead you too much. Won't lead the witness on the question, but like what bucket list hunt that is on your list you haven't done?
I'll kind of like backpedal a little bit. So the reason I started waterfowl is because I'm doing like a cooking series for my channel. So I actually have a lot of different hunts I would like to try to start doing to kind of incorporate into cooking and okay. like creating recipes for different types of wild game. So I have a lot of like bucket list hunts I want to do. I'd say my like dream hunt is to shoot like a really nice caribou with my bow. But I mean, like I would love to, you know, obviously shoot an elk, like a moose is on the list. You know, just anything that I haven't really done. Like I haven't really bear hunted. I'd love to do that. You know, just a bunch of stuff because I feel like one, obviously that'd be really cool and really fun, but also like I've noticed with my content that a lot of people like they see us going out, they see us hunting, and then that's all they see, but they don't see like everything that's like behind the scenes. So I really want to kind of show, okay, this is what I'm doing after I shoot this animal. You know, this is how I'm utilizing it, and you know, kind of just make it like a full circle project of like, you know, we're scouting, we're prepping, we're going out, we're hunting. This is how we're hunting. And then, you know, after the fact, you know, we're consuming it and utilizing it. So, I mean, I would love to just do a bunch of hunts now.
That's awesome. Yeah. Let's change it. What's your best recipe and will you share it with us?
Well, you'll have to go to my YouTube channel to watch it. I really love like slow cooker meals. I think they're really great for wild game because a lot of wild game is like tough. So I love wild turkey with like turkey gravy in a slow cooker. Falls apart and then you just put it with mashed potatoes. It's amazing. And then I would say my favorite dish that I make is pesto pasta, and you can do it with any kind of ground like meat. So like venison, elk, you know, whatever. And it's very similar to like a spaghetti lasagna, but like pesto. I don't really know how to explain it, but it's like so good. Like, I love it. I make it at least once a week.
You said that, is that one on the YouTube that I can go?
Not yet. It should be like in a few weeks.
Okay. Well, I'll look forward to that one.
Yeah, it's so good.
Yeah. Recently went on a elk hunt and got all that meat back, and now I'm trying to figure out, you know, all the things I can do with that. I think we're going to try to do like a few different things here at the office and make some stuff for some people and see what they think. But I might have to pick your brain a bit. And if this was you, what would you make?
You guys keep talking about food. It's like lunchtime here. I don't know, John. You might try picking up my stomach growling on the microphone now. But.
So like with that, I know, so you're working on recipes. Have you always just enjoyed cooking and that whole thing? Or is this like a whole new thing, or just now trying to tell that story to everybody?
So, no. It's actually funny. My mom gives me a hard time because when I was younger, she used to, like, my mom loves to cook and bake and stuff, and she was always trying to get me to like help her in the kitchen, and I just never had any interest in it. But like through college and stuff, like I lived alone and then I lived with like roommates, and I kind of had to like learn how to make food for myself. Yeah. So it just kind of like started there. And now like that I'm older and, you know, I'm just cooking all the time now. So I have learned to really enjoy it. And I feel like it's like more of a science than most people realize. And I love like anything that's like sciencey, intricate like that. So it fascinates me, like what you can create.
Yeah.
And now obviously like with hunting, which I mean, I've always hunted, but now that I'm really like hunting a lot, yeah. I'm like, okay, I need to make something out of all this. So it's been fun, like just kind of experimenting. And eventually I think I would like to have a cookbook with like my own recipes that I've, you know, curated and stuff like that. So it's kind of just grown into a thing.
That's cool.
Yeah.
So are you going to be covering then, since you're sort of doing the full story, the processing as well?
Yeah, I would like to. I'm still in the baby stages of it. Like right now it's just like, if I'm showing a recipe, it's just like me cooking, but I definitely want to show more of like that, like the whole thing. Yeah. You know, 'cause I feel like people can learn from that too. So just showing the whole process. I'm not entirely sure how to go about it just yet, but I might like have somebody help me film, because I'm mostly doing a lot of it by myself, which makes it difficult to show like everything. But I do want to do that for sure.
Oh, that's cool. So I'll look forward to that recipe so I can attempt it and fail. Yeah. And then
I heard you're bringing it into the office.
Oh, I am. Yeah.
Perfect.
Yeah. Yeah, you'll all be the test subjects. Wait,
after you perfect it, maybe next
sure.
year.
Sure. Second time. So
he's going to be like, if it sucks, it's Caitlin's fault.
Right, yeah.
I follow the instructions. Not me.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I didn't measure or time anything. So that's not me. Yeah. Well, thanks for joining us. We'll probably follow up with you early next year on this and kind of see how the season went. And then I'll definitely, you'll see my comment on that YouTube video for the recipe, and I'll let you know how it went.
Okay.
Really appreciate you joining us, and we'll talk to you soon.
Yeah, good luck.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks for having me.